All right, so originally we were going to talk but you know, did all of the midterms, put up all the grades. Here's the distribution. Okay. So people are doing really well. There. And if you want to meet with me and go over your midterm, I have them all, so just come to my office hours or schedule an appointment. Okay. But the questions people got wrong were mostly these questions. Okay, so I think this stuff is important, so I'm sure everyone's getting it. So I'm going to go back and review it. Not in trouble. Okay. We'll help you in the final. So here's the midterm. So for this one, this one's worth 12.5 points. If you got this one wrong, I'm going to go to 6 points. And it's a lot. 12.5 points is a lot. Okay, so things like Ichthyonis dispar and Geospiza were clade. Does that work? Fig wasps and leafcutter ants. Does that work? So it's pretty little. There's some things where things like anomalous charis and some arthropod. I was pretty generous with scoring as a that's trilobite. Probably not, but I counted it. Okay. and they're just knowing the tree. So taphonomic bias. What's taphonomic bias? Ooh, it's now on the final. And so, taphonomy, you know, all these preserve, and then bias. Okay, so the bias is the two aggregates. and so, in thinking about Cope's rule, you want to think about things like a size bias. Right, so not only do we have trouble getting fossils, but the set of fossils we get, are they biased towards big things or small things, and why? This one's in a lot of trouble. This question, people mostly got right. Right? And the thing you're trying to look for is you're thinking about different fitnesses and sexes. Okay? So if males have higher fitness, then those genes that lead to having more males in the offspring increase in frequency, and they get to 50-50. Okay? So now that each individual has half 50-50, you could have two genes in population, one where females only have males, one where females only have females. How do they get through? The good of the species is not relevant. So, I'm talking about that's your overall fitness to have a lot of people. It can actually be better if you had, all females and just one male. In fact, that you have much more reproduction. There's, interesting variation with the variant of the leptis. Yeah. All right. So mostly people did well. The justification, they got some very weird answers here. So, quadrats, trees, things like that. So, what are they talking about? Right, speciation minus extinction. Right? So speciation. Okay. So in the context of this class on a tree, when we go from one species to two species. Right? There's also chronospecies. Right? So when we have one lineage that becomes different enough to start following something else. Okay? That's not really relevant for this sort of discussion, but it's a complicating factor. You can use fossil data. You can use modern data with phylogenies. Don't worry about that. Okay? You don't worry about missing. If there's a species right here and I don't have the information to put up, it could be that bias. Okay? example, cattle egrets settled into North America from Africa, sometime in the 20th century, and they're no longer interbreeding with the African one. So they're different species. Well, maybe, but there's nothing to distinguish them. Okay. So that's what that would be. Okay. Distinction, distinctions. All right, so here's we have these nectar stores. What are nectar stores? So there was a cup with that being split in. And so we have a right one come into the window. Okay. So the famous case. there's a flower that, in Madagascar, it's a really long, it's 15 centimeter long nectar spray. And so what could be, you know, pollinating it? So Darwin predicted it would be a hawk moth found becoming that moth. And then decades later, they found it. And then they also did that video of pollinating. Okay. So yeah, so there are a mechanism that allows, you know, bees to hang. So it's got to help with the diversification. I meant that being. So if I have flowers through nectar spurs, lengths, right, they tend to get some pollinators. Even though this pollinator can actually get both, they tend to get some pollinators. Okay, so what? So it's a little distinction from that, the speciation. Right. So the hundred pollinators, so what leads to speciation? What is speciation? So this, if you have different pollinators, results in lack of gene flow, right? It's like moss and pollinating this flower and moss and pollinating this flower. And you don't cross pollinate, you just turned off gene flow, okay? Even in the same environment. Okay? And that was within the speciation. Okay? So they may not be adaptive. It may not be that, like, these ones live in drier habitats and these ones live in wetter habitats or something like that. Just, you know, they could have been allopatrically separated. They typically evolve different nectar spur lengths, and they come back together. They can maintain distinctness and sympatry because of lack of gene. That makes sense? Yes? Okay. So, it might increase speciation rate. Okay. Change to Y, it might increase extinction rate, too. Does anyone else repeat that? Right. Yeah. But that, you know, one wild with things hanging along the tongue goes extinct. A flood. Okay, good. So why do we care? This is a big field of study. And this is a little bit different problems. So why do we care about English, that's why. But refugee, why does this matter? Why do people care about it? Yeah, see humans, you see a horse. So why do we see so many different species of plants out there? Maybe it's more biomass or plants, but that's what sort of question to ask, right? But unfortunately, why is more than what it is? It's like, why do you see so many species of orchids and more species of birds? And this sort of question about why the world is the way it is. Another question is participation. Why do you think participation? So if flowers species more readily. Species more readily. And we can see more top species. But a separate question is numerical. Right? So we can see, maybe there's a million buffalo, all of them species, and 1,000 orchid species, each of them 1,000 individuals. Same number of bodies, species. But these are different questions. Participation alone tells us that. Care about the question.
sense.
That's why this is a big question for an evolution. Trying to understand this. We have methods to do this. So how do you figure out this persecution in this case?
Interspersed. So
these, so this slash, with these have interspersed and this is damage. That's somewhere else in this. How do you figure out the depreciation rate doesn't have to be extension rate. Right? Why do you use net turnover? Depreciation plus extension. What is something that we have on net certification? Depreciation minus extension. How do you teach that? Right, there could be another trait here. So it could be. In A's metric spread, maybe these are white, we've lost some sign. Maybe that makes some more practice. What else? In this case, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 48, 49, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 65, 66, 67, 68, 69, 70, 71, 72, 73, 74, 75, 76, 77, 78, 79, 80, 81, 82, 83, 84, 85, 86, 87, 88, 79, 90, 91, 92, 93, 94, 95, 96, 97, 98, 99, 100, 101, 102, 103, 104, 105, 106, 107, 108, 109, 110, 111, 112, 113, 114, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28,
That seems like a big difference. Is it significant?
That person wants things up a lot. How do you test that that's significant? That's how you expect. What have we done the past 2 days? What? Build a model. Right? So what do you model to test that?
Mm-hmm.
So what would a model be? Right, so what we can do is create a null model. It just has, okay, this is it. So we want to see, does this create a specification? So the null model, which has species evolving under constant speciation extinction. So then we'll create trees like this. I'll see, okay, it's, you know, 2-3 ratio. And I'll see it again and get a different tree. And I'll get a 4-to-1 ratio. Okay? And I'll submit many times and get they always put it so that it's always 1-to-4, so it becomes on the right. Okay? I'll get some ratio like this. Right? We only get 1-to-1 and we get more than 1-to-1. Right? And then I can see, where is 15-to-1 on this curve? Right? Is it here? Or is it way out here? Okay? And that's a very simple way to test this. Right? So you have a very simple null model, and you have your simple test statistic of 15-to-1. Is that significant? Okay? Anyone know offhand? So the critical value is actually about 39. So if I have a tree in balance such that 39 of the taxa are on one side and one is on the other side, that or more even ratio happens 95% of the time. So if you want to do 95%, then 30-to-1, 15-to-1, it's all within that 95% of what you put under the whole model. Okay, so after in this case, using that test, it's a great test, it's not significant. So what we get from this are how to use null models for this and how to do a diversification test. That's good. All right, so then what? Are we done?
What? Okay, good. So we could be done. So we could say, okay, yeah, we did a test, didn't work, fine. And that's actually a valid thing to show in science, right? So you did a test, couldn't find anything, report the result. Well, we have other data too, we could do branch length information. And we'll get to that in two slides about how we use that. But excellent. We had a concern about how quickly they're diversified as well as just the number. What else could we do if our question were, do nectar spurs increase diversification rate? They did.
So, actually, I believe there's 70 species in show 15. So it's 70 versus 1, 4 versus 14, and which tree it is. Is it Aquilegia versus some Aquilegia, or the Aquilegia versus Magellan? Either way, the two progression shows Aquilegia wins. Okay. Maybe 350 versus this. 450 versus this. Okay. So, we're going to get p-values using this test we're talking about, which comparison. It's also using the sun and cross comparisons. Okay. So, first one counts as a win. Second one counts as a win. Third one counts as a win. Fourth one counts as a win. Fifth one counts as a win. Second one counts as a loss. Right? That makes sense? Okay. So what basically I'm saying, do nectar spurs increase diversification rate? It's like saying, is heads more likely? Well, they have more diversity in the head side. That makes sense? Okay. So what do you do here? Yeah. Distribution, so you use a binomial, you can use a binomial test, you can just do a sign test if you wanted to. Okay? But various ways to see, do we have more pluses than we expect under model equal chance? This is another way to test diversification. So what are some good points about this test? Rather than just looking at just Aquilegia or the semi Aquilegia.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yep. So we got that. So the sign test, so 350, 450, 280, they're very round numbers, right? We could also do a test to see what's the value of the zero. Chance. You have 10 fingers and it's about 80 pieces.
So then it's a little bit suspect. But for this test, if we had 70 versus 69, then maybe we'd worry about the count. we have 450 versus 15. You can be off by quite a lot and either be a member and still know the same result.
Good. On the other hand,
the fact that we know it's, you know, 245 versus 2, which should tell us that the model is a huge difference. We said p-values, the scientists
pick it up. So what's another advantage of doing analysis like this with many sister comparisons rather than single comparison here?
Could it be that we got lucky? These, you know, live in the tropics and this lives in temperature. All less. As we were confusing all of our microscope with things with, you know, bad geography differences. Right? But when we do across many comparisons, maybe this will be added out for those different errors. Creating those these are tropical ones.
You can interpret that one. Okay, good. So we'll see how these tests give us information about diversification. Okay. Okay, now the branch length thing. All right. So here we have a phylogeny of some fishes.
And Lewis freshwater red marine. What do you think about diversification rate? Can you do a two comparison? Can I do a statistical comparison on this one? Why say no? Alright, let's go to right here. So we can have two red. They're on the same trees, okay. You know, they looked at nectarspores across those many plant groups. There is one tree of plants. I only looked at one part of that tree from my study, but it's all one big tree. That's just a direction that you can do across a single tree. So here I have freshwater. Two to one here. Okay. What about this one? That's hard to do, right? But. Oh. Yeah. So, here we have marine, there's a mixture of fresh water in there. So this could be a problem. So people dealing with this, there's a bit of people who say, well, that blue, these red ones are blue, which is all of them, and we can have a problem. That's right. So one versus one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten, nine, ten, 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 ten. This one, we have to put the same as this one. And this, one versus seven. Okay. This one, but then we have this. Are you starting this year? We have to do the same test again. I do this test though.
What do you think?
We could start here with some sort of clean test.
What do you think? So we do that 40-to-1 rule. Didn't this work? You need to be 39 times greater to have it significant. And are you going to be significant? Nope.
Okay. So this one's dire.
what about overall?
So let's say you have green, fresh, fresh, fresh.
So I can 50-50? Yeah.
So then this is definitely unfair.
Green versus fresh. Vision. One if yes, two if no. Significant? Okay. You're correct.
So you get significance here with just five, and this one, you need to have all five be N or all five be F. So if you don't have.
All right.
Using those tests is not significant. Right. But that's just looking at hunting species in ecology. What about branch lengths? Okay. That's a good point. What do branch lengths tell us? So what does this branch here?
Why is it that length, not shorter or longer? Mm-hmm. A time, good.
You can call it wave three. Okay, time you can go up and left. Right, exactly. So it has, you know, initiated it here, and it'll go a while, and then initiate again.
Okay. Well, what things have a faster speciation rate look like on this tree? Shorter branch lengths, right?
So, if, you know, I'm coughing a lot here, the time between coughs is pretty short. Okay. If I'm coughing a lot, the time between coughs is longer. So if you estimate the coughing rate, by the time you've had two inches of coughs. Okay. Take the initiation.
Is there a complication here?
This is just in the time of initiation notes.
No, who knows? Why not?
What else is happening to species in this tree?
Extinction.
Extinction happens. Okay.
There's only extinct stuff. Not shown, right? Why?
And she'll have these easy. Is it relevant? If we have full knowledge of, you know, extinct species too. We've been using to exclude them. Maybe we only care about what's happening in front of the scenes at the same time. Right? But it's going to tell us something about actual next speciation. Right? So if I knew that here I had no speciation events, that triggered me saying I had appreciate, and then a much higher turnover rate, and it's going to slow some natrification. Right? So this tree just shows natrification, it's not just shows speciation and extinction separately. Direct way. And the reason for that is this tree is made up of mud and beta that is fossil plant. And so they're going to have some genes that the tree didn't get. then go to fossil record and try to extract DNA from dead fish. Right? And so I'm also getting them back. And so, there are other things we don't see. Okay. And so, this is time between speciation events. There's time between speciation events that might be descendants. There are other speciation events that we don't see. Okay. There are two different approaches for this to deal with this. One is to say, there's no distinction, right? And we've seen this at the point called a pure growth tree. That's an accepted method to use all the time. And it's very attractive, right? You can say, oh, this is definitely speciation rights. Okay. And then approaches are ways to deal with extinction. That's to put extinction into the model. But there's still some information here about extinction. and so they use one of the latter models. Okay. We're talking about Bissi. You're talking about Bissi? Really know value into that question. Statistical comparisons, you could do a Sussex-Geier test, or you could do a Bissi model. Any of those would get full credit. Okay. So here we have speciation rates. What is it from this plot? Measuring something equivalent to how long the speciation is. That plot, of course, the plot shows nitrification, not just speciation. So, what does the blue distribution mean? When we talk about posteriors, Bayesian, what does that mean? Look at this, it synthesizes all the stuff that I've been jabbering about, if not teaching. What?
Right, so we have a posterior combines our prior belief with the likelihood coming from our data to get this distribution of the probability of this value. Okay?
And so it gives us a range. Right? So an unaffected probability is this very much filled in. So an unaffected sure is a true value. Outside of the range,
so it was a higher speciation rate.
Which is a higher extinction rate, freshwater or marine? Freshwater. Okay. So the fish shake faster. Let's go extinct faster.
Okay. So now let's look at this tree. Look at the tree again and see if you can see why that might be.
And as long as that's the only data that goes into calculating that rate, these are the central to it.
Good. Yeah. Excellent question.
Yeah, and so people understand the question? Right, so probability go from 0 to 1. So the probability of getting heads can't be 6. And probably going extinct, can't be 5. It's 500% probability you won't go extinct.
You're having a really bad day.
but what this is actually doing, so it's a density. So if it were a binomial thing, where it's, a histogram, the height of this bar is probably being in this, discrete area, right? So, for here, actually, if one of the probably being in this area here, so some sort of distribution, it's actually an area. Okay, so the area has to be, the total area of the whole thing has to sum to one, right? But the height can be different. So, let's say my probability density function or like this. Right? Okay, and so that means this height would be 1, right? This area would be 1. Okay. But I could also do something like this. With the same area, right, but the height greater than 1. Okay, but any sort of interval I take is 1 or smaller in terms of area.
Cool. That makes sense? That sounds to everyone else?
Yeah. And it's something that if you develop methods, so you take the log of this and then the log of this is negative, and you get negative probability. Or negative log of probability.
That's good.
All right.
stuff that is higher speciation, higher extinction. What's the chance? So the mean of blue is bigger than the mean of red. So we write the tell signs, yay, diversification rate is much higher in fresh water. We know this really well.
So, do we? No.
So the point estimate is higher. Right? The mean of this is blue bigger than the red.
Okay. But,
what?
Compelling story if you had something like this. Right? Oh wow, the speed is really much higher. Right? Instead, we have this. So it's much higher. It's much higher, but there's a huge range of numbers. We can say with a lot of confidence that it's much higher. What we could actually do is figure out which of the time that we would bear that. That's by far less than.
And in this paper, they make a big point about expectation speciation rates being higher in fresh water. They say, it's a cool high natural expectation rate, but you can't tell for that.
Okay. So, just like our, you know, our sign test, which wasn't significant, and our Sozzi-Geyer test, the 39 to 1 test, wasn't significant. Here, we don't see a significance for these natural. So why bother doing it? We didn't get significance, we failed. Exactly. And so the science that you're trying to do is learn stuff. And so,
you know, we have right here an estimate that shows, okay, we got good at, actually we have good evidence here, but the base is very similar. So we don't see that green is 10 times the rate of fresh water, vice versa. We actually learned something from the results of it. Learn that they were super. Okay, that's the structure. Okay. We've also learned that the implicit difference is actually the efficient amount. Okay?
So here you see how we can do these diversification analyses when we can learn from them. Right? And also a little bit about why we care about doing this stuff. We care about explaining the world. This helps us explain the world. Okay, any questions? Okay, so on Friday now, chemical origin of life. If you have questions about your test, let me know.